Now, what you're looking at here is the organization of McClellan's army at different dates. And, of course, the total strength of his army depends upon Lincoln releasing to McClellan divisions, 10,000 men in a division, to complement his army. Now, when he began to move the army from Washington to Fort Monroe, McClellan assumed that he was going to have a certain quantity of men. And as we've learned, halfway down the Potomac to Fort Monroe, he's informed by Lincoln that he's lost 40,000 men. He's taken them away. And that's McDowell's corps of three divisions. And then a week or so later, with McClellan whining about it, Lincoln releases one division from that corps. And that's Franklin's division, which we talked about coming down on transports to come up the York River and get into the rear of the fortifications of the enemy there. And so on April the 4th, which is the day essentially that McClellan began his army's march up the peninsula, this is the amount of force he had. He had with him on the 4th two corps, Heintzelman's corps with these three divisions and Key's corps with these three divisions. All these other forces on April the 4th were still en route from Washington. Sumner's corps and, of course, McDowell's corps has been detached. So by the time McClellan arrived in front of Yorktown, he arrived with six divisions. Sumner's corps arrives later. And now it's almost 5-6 weeks later, and McClellan has reached where we are now at Cumberland Landing, St. Peter's Church, and he's reorganized. He's reorganized his army, and he's done it with some political problems. What he wanted to do, he's got two close friends. One of them is Fitzjohn Porter, who has a division in Heintzelman's corps, and the other one is Franklin, who we talked about being on the boats. And what McClellan wants to do is he wants to give Fitzjohn Porter a corps, and he wants to give Franklin a corps. And to do that, he wants to take Porter's division out of Heintzelman's division, and he wants to take out of it another division from Key's corps to make up what's called the Fifth Corps that's commanded by Porter. And he wants to do the same thing with Franklin. Use Franklin's division and take another division from these other areas to make up the Sixth Corps. And so by the 16th of 1862, this is the setup. He's got now five corps. And these first two fellas, Heintzelman and Keyes, instead of having three divisions each, have only got two. So that's the essential problem that causes him difficulty. At this time, Lincoln writes him a letter. And in the letter, he says this: "Your complaint about army organization is seen as an effort to pamper your pets and to degrade their supposed rivals, which is Keyes and Heintzelman's. I am told," Lincoln says, "you consult with nobody but Porter and Franklin. When you relieved Hamilton the other day, you lost friends. Do you think yourself strong enough to step on the necks of Sumner, Heintzelman, and Keyes all at once?" So you can see there's a great deal of politics going on here. McClellan moved on now to Tunstall Station, which he used as his first depot. The train that you see is authentic, as is the station.
We've reached Dispatch Station now. We're about a mile and a half from the Chickahominy River. We're going to walk up the tracks to the river. As you walk west on the line of the railroad tracks, you can come across an old wagon road to the north of the line of tracks. This wagon road may or may not have been built by McClellan's forces, but certainly as you go up the road, the land becomes swamp, and the railroad bed itself has to be elevated some considerable height above grade to keep the tracks dry when the heavy rains of spring come and totally inundate the land with water. And you can see that as you get close to the river. This gives you an idea of the volume of tonnage that McClellan needed to be transported up this railroad on a daily basis to his front on the Chickahominy. Well, as you can see, we've reached the York River Railroad bridge crossing of the Chickahominy River. Now, the river itself is about, in terms of its channels, there are multiple channels, so that if we continued on across this bridge another 100 yards or so, we'd come along to a similar bridge as the stream meanders through what we have here as the Chickahominy Swamp. Now, by May 25th, McClellan had been able to get the front of his army up to this location. And between where we are and about a mile downstream, we have Keyes and Heintzelman's corps that are crossing the river. And they're going to continue forward toward Richmond, which is about 7 miles away, as the other troops come up behind them. And we're going to go on to Seven Pines, where McClellan establishes his fortifications. It's the first line that he was going to establish to maintain his position in front of Richmond. McClellan's problem is that he has to bring his right wing 3 more corps. You remember Fitzjohn Porter's corps and William Franklin's corps, and we have Sumner's corps. And these corps are proceeding on the north side of this bridge,
extending about 4 miles north toward a place called Newbridge, a key spot in the situation. As you can see around us, we're in the middle of a swamp, but it's a clear day, it's dry. McCullen's problem was that it was raining incessantly from almost the day he arrived on April the 4th at Fort Monroe on board the steamer Commodore until he was able to get through Yorktown, get through Williamsburg, make his decision where his base was going to be, and then come forward here. So this is not going to be a very difficult task to bridge this river, to establish the causeways that are necessary to reach the river. These kinds of obstacles were very practical problems for McCullen to deal with. Now, on the opposite side of the river, about a mile beyond Seven Pines, which we'll reach next, the Confederate Army commander, Joseph Johnston, is going to attempt to push McCullen's left wing back across the Chickahominy. And that's going to be really the first battle that occurs of serious consequence for McCullen's position here. Now, the railroad, as I've mentioned before, is the most critical problem McCullen has to deal with. This railroad represents his line of communication, his source of supply, that extends 15 miles back behind us to the White House landing that we've seen on the mouth of the Pamunkey River. And the further forward he goes toward Richmond, obviously the longer this line that he has to protect becomes. So security for the railroad is the most critical factor in his analysis of how safe his army is. If he loses his connection to the mouth of the Pamunkey, then his army would be in serious trouble, wouldn't it? And Joe Johnston is not apparently concentrating on that specific problem. Instead, Johnston is going to try to, by frontal assaults, push against the front of McCullen and try to get him pushed back across the river. We've reached Seven Pines, which is about 3 miles further west from the position that we were at. On May 31, Joe Johnston's army attacked McCullen's front at this location. The front extending about a mile to the north where the York River Railroad passes on to Richmond. Now, McCullen had Casey's division of Keyes Corps at this location. Casey's line was broken and his men fled back about a mile to McCullen's main line. And over the day, McCullen had to bring up additional troops. And this is in a severe rainstorm, and the Chickahominy River is flooded over that boggy area that you saw down there by the railroad bridge, so that the columns of Union troops that were crossing the river on these rickety bridges that had just been built reached this side of the river just before the bridges collapsed and were able to reach this area and support McCullen's front line and stabilize it. Now, in that process, Joseph Johnston was acting much like Sidney Johnston did at the Battle of Shiloh a month ago. If you know much about the Civil War, you know that Sidney Johnston was killed during the battle as he tried to organize fresh troops to drive forward and push Grant into the Tennessee River. And at this crucial moment, when he was just about at the point to do that, he was killed. Joseph Johnson was not killed, but he was wounded. He was carried from the battlefield. And it's because of his injury that General Lee stepped into the role of field commander for the Army of Northern Virginia. Now, Joe Johnson had retreated from Manassas in front of Washington down to the Rappahannock because the Union forces that were gathering in front of him under McClellan's command were almost twice the size of his army. And similarly, on the Yorktown Peninsula, the reason that Johnson retreated from Yorktown and at the end of the day did not defend those fortifications we talked about is that his army was still not strong enough to stand up to the weight of McClellan's manpower. And Joe Johnson made the decision really against the wishes of President Davis and the advice of General Lee. He made the decision to retire up the peninsula and over the Chickahominy and stand here just within 4 miles of Richmond. I'll show you now on a map the tactical problems that both McClellan and Johnson had to deal with in making the decision how one versus the other was going to deal with the situation.
McClellan's essential problem is that he has to swing his right across the Chickahominy to connect to his left. And there are some very deep ravines on the Richmond side of the Chickahominy in front of Highland Springs that makes it extremely difficult to move troops northward along the right bank of the Chickahominy, trying to extend the line toward Newbridge and Old Tavern. McClellan's got to bring Franklin's corps across the Chickahominy at the New Bridge crossing, where he's built a series of bridges, and bring it up a road that climbs about 1,500 feet in elevation to the top of the bluff that forms the Richmond Plateau, so that he'll be able to get his right flank connected to the Chickahominy Bluff just a bit below Mechanicsville in a position to move forward toward Richmond and seize this critical spot on the map called Old Tavern. If he can bring his big Parrott guns into operation at Old Tavern, he'll be able to throw 150-pound shells into the very center of Richmond. And under the barrage of these guns, his infantry can continue to dig zigzag trenches forward to get as close as possible to the rebel fortifications and then storm them. That essentially is what has to happen here.
We've just come from Seven Pines, and we're on what's called Lee Avenue today. 150 years ago, this road was a wagon road. It was called the New Bridge Road. And we're going to be approaching, as we go down this road for a length of about 2 miles, the bluffs that overlook the Chickahominy bottomland. At a position where there was a bridge, and this bridge was called the New Bridge. And it's this bridge, as I mentioned to you,
when we discuss the map at Seven Pines, this bridge is critical to McClellan's operation. Remember that he's got to get his right wing across the Chickahominy in order to connect to his left wing and thereby extend his line, anchoring both his flanks, his left flank being anchored on White Oak Swamp and his right flank being anchored on the Chickahominy. With the position that we're at as we're coming down this hill being critical to him, he wants to get his heavy Parrott rifle guns up here on this bluff at this location, which would bring the city of Richmond within range of the fire of those guns. And if you look down the hill now, you'll see the slope that we're going to go down here. And you can get an idea of the incline, how steep it is, the angle of decline. It's considerable. And it's up this slope that McClellan has got to get his troops. Now ahead of us you see that the road ends. What you see there is a dirt road. Now that road represents the wagon road that comes up from the bottomland from Newbridge. And 20 years ago, if we'd been here, we'd be able to drive down that road. But we're being prohibited from doing that today by a cable stretched across it. But we've got another mile to go down the same length of incline, and we'll walk down it a bit just to show you what we're talking about. We've reached Beaver Dam Creek. We're going to take a minute now, we're going to shift from concentrating on McClellan and his point of view and turning now to the issue of General Lee. Back at Seven Pines, Joe Johnson was wounded, taken from the field. General Lee took command of the Army of Northern Virginia. That was on May 31, 1862. Now we're standing here on June 25, 1862, almost a month later. During those 3 to 4 weeks that General Lee had command of the Army of Northern Virginia, he totally reorganized it and selected from a number of officers a select group that would stay with him through the entire war. Immediately he began to plan to attack McClellan's line of communication with the mouth of the Papunkey River, the York River Railroad. And the way he intended to do it, I'm going to show you on a map here in a minute. But first I'll read some brief excerpts from the historical record to cover that 1 month period. McClellan, of course, is well aware of the issue of security for his railroad, and he's constantly carping to President Lincoln that he needs more men, especially the rest of those divisions that were withheld as part of McDowell's Corps. So, for example, on June 5, the record shows that Lincoln was again considering sending McDowell's Corps down to McClellan. At the same time, McClellan is giving the War Department on almost a daily basis an update of where he's at, because he's getting constant pressure to actually mount attacks. Same pressure that he received at Yorktown. So for an example, on June the 7th, he wrote Secretary of War Stanton, "I shall be in perfect readiness to move forward and take Richmond the moment McCall arrives." Now McCall's division is part of McDowell's Corps, which Lincoln is now releasing. And McDowell's Corps is going to come down the Potomac River to Chesapeake Bay. He's going to steam his way up to the White House Landing, and then he's going to march, or he's going to take the railroad into Richmond. On June the 10th, McClellan wires Stanton, I'm completely checked by the weather. I shall attack as soon as the weather and ground will permit. On the 13th of June, McCall's division arrives. It's integrated into the corps of Fitzjohn Porter, and it's put in position here in front of us. And if Jeremy will take a little bit of control of the camera, and McCall's division is put into position right here in front of us, and if you pan down, you'll see where we're at. We're standing in the basin of a piece of Beaver Dam Creek, and if you can see through the trees across from us, and perhaps zoom in a little bit, you'll realize that we're down in a deep depression here, and that's a steep incline. That's a steep bank up there in those trees, in this direction over here. You can see how that rise goes up where the leaves go up, and the same situation is behind us. So we're in a deep trough. This is like a moat, and this stream and this geography that you see in front of you here, this topography, it stretches around for 3 miles in a half moon circle, protecting what? Protecting McClellan's right flank. Because McClellan, in order to maintain possession of his railroad, has now committed Fitzjohn Porter's corps, supported by Franklin's corps, to face in this direction on that rim up there to block any effort of the enemy to get into his rear. That's what's happening here. And he's reinforced Porter with McDowell's corps. Now, on June the 14th, the day after McDowell arrives, Mack wires Washington, "I shall advance as soon as the bridges are completed and the ground fit for artillery to move." And again, he asks for full control of McDowell's corps. On June the 20th, see, a whole month is passing here while McClellan is telling Washington, you know, he's ready to move, but there's these other reasons, these excuses that are interfering with his ability to get the emotion going. On June the 20th, he wires and he tells Washington, "By tomorrow night, the defensive works covering our position on the right bank of the river will be completed." Now he's on the 21st. On the 25th, "Our bridges and entrenchments are completed and we're going to advance our picket lines now." Now at the same time, June the 25th, you know, the dynamics of this thing is changing, because through these 3 to 4 weeks that passed from Seven Pines to the point we're at, General Lee has ordered Stonewall Jackson, who has two divisions. He's over 120 miles away in the Shenandoah Valley, to approach Richmond from the north at a place called Ashland, and then approach McClellan's right flank and rear. And in the process of giving that order, General Lee sends to Stonewall Jackson another division to bolster the force that's going to end up on this side of the Chickahominy and north of Beaver Dam Creek. Now let me show you on the map what we're talking about here in terms of strategy. Let me get a pen out and we'll look at this map. Now, we've seen this map before. These markings that are on this map, we made at Seven Pines. And you can recall how important it is for McClellan, if he's ever going to have a successful siege, to establish control of this point in order to bombard Richmond. And we talked about Joe Johnston, when he was in command, the idea of going around McClellan's right flank, and how McClellan, to eliminate that threat, had to extend his line to the Chickahominy as we have it here, and then down to White Oak Swamp. Now, what General Lee's plan is not so much a tactical flanking move around the flank of McClellan, but a strategic one. And my friend Jeremy Barbanel here would refer to that as the go-around principle. And Jeremy would also talk about the concept of splitting your forces. And Jeremy's ideas are founded in some serious ancient military science that General Lee is adapting to what then is a modern experience in 1862. What General Lee is going to do is he's going to send forces. Before I mention that, let me add in, you see, back a month ago we talked about Porter and Franklin and the need for them to cross the Chickahominy. Well, once it becomes clear to McClellan that his rear is going to get threatened any day, he's forced to commit these two corps to a defensive position right where we're at. Here's the Chickahominy, and here's this stream. And Ellerson's Mill is at basically the mouth of the stream, and the stream wraps around for about 3 or 4 miles. It wraps around, and it has two branches to it. Now draw in the branches. And we're right here. We're standing right here. Now, General Lee has got a mass of troops. He's got his troops massed in this area. He's got James Longstreet and his troops massed in this area. And he's got A.P. Hill massed up here. And he's got Stonewall Jackson, who's been marching all the way from the Shenandoah Valley, and he's going to come down Paul Green Church Road, which is where we're at. So General Lee's idea is to have a mass of troops hit this point. They're all going to attack through Beaver Dam Creek, through this defensive position. And it's Porter's responsibility, supported by Franklin, to resist that pressure against the flank. Now, the railroad, if you remember, is at the bottom of the map. So, in breaking through this line, the whole idea is to get down to that railroad, to get onto that railroad. And Stonewall, he's the guy the farthest out. His idea is to get all the way down there, get to that railroad. So it's this pressure coming against McClellan's right flank that is going to force McClellan to stop attempting to move forward to this key position on the right bank of the Chickahominy and start exerting all of his energy and just holding back this pressure that's coming at him from the north. That's General Lee's plan. I said I was going to say something about George McClellan's performance, professional performance as a soldier. And it's at this location now that issue is coming to a head. Because McClellan's got a simple decision he has to make. It's a hard one, but it's not complicated. Is he going to fight for that railroad? Is he going to fight for possession and control of that railroad or not? And if he's not, then there's no way he can remain where he is. This whole idea of advancing against Richmond these last 3 or 4 miles is gone without that railroad. So, 23rd of June, the 24th of June, from his cavalry reports, McClellan knows that Stonewall Jackson with a column of 3 divisions is getting closer and closer to this location that we're standing on. And he knows that the enemy has massed troops over here waiting for Stonewall to arrive, and they're going to join in an attack on his rear. He knows this, McClellan. And does he fight for his railroad? The answer is no. He doesn't fight for his railroad. He starts to plan a movement to escape from this pressure that's coming against him. Is that a grievous error on his part? That's a very tough question to answer. I mean, historians and Civil War writers have no problem cavalierly pontificating. Had McClellan decided to fight for his railroad, fight for his communications, objectively, it seems pretty clear that this would have been one tough struggle to overpower that defensive line and force those people to fall back. But as the record shows, McClellan decided to abandon his communications. He decided intellectually the necessity of abandoning his communications. And he ordered Fitz John Porter to fall back to a place called Gaines Mill and hold that position long enough for McClellan to move his entire army, animals, men, artillery, wagon trains, 18, 20 miles south of here, down to the James River, to Malvern Hill, and to Harrison's Landing, where he established a new base of operations, which he considered to be secure from this kind of an attack. Now, whether he was right or wrong on that point, the historians have a great time criticizing him. But in terms of military performance and military practice, it's very difficult to second guess McClellan under the circumstances that confronted him.
We'll go on to part 3 now, following McClellan in his change of base. First visiting Gaines Mill, really the little stream valley of Boatswain's Creek, where Fitz John Porter put up a magnificent defense against almost the entire weight of General Lee's army. And we'll follow McClellan from Malvern Hill to Harrison's Landing and the fabulous estate of Benjamin Harrison, a signer of the Declaration of Independence, which still stands on the James River. And then we'll have something final to say about McClellan, and then we'll We'll go with General Lee on his move against Pope.
In the winter of 65, we were hungry, just barely alive. I took the track.